may be seated. Let us unite our voices with our opening prayer. God of extravagant grace, may your Spirit refresh our hearts through the reading of the Scriptures, that we may perceive all the good we can do for Christ, and so grow in our faith toward the Lord Jesus. Amen. I would point you to the announcements in our bulletin this morning. There are many wonderful things going on in the life of St. John's Church. We encourage you to prayerfully consider each of these to determine what God may be calling you to be a part of. Today, our beautiful flowers are given to the glory of God and in memory of Christine Caprell by N.L. Caprell. Also, they are offered today and to the glory of God and in memory of Dr. Robert Clyburn in honor of his 84th birthday. And these are given by his lovely wife and his children. Several other announcements I would bring to your attention this morning. First of all, you all look great today. Really good. But you look like you could use a little ice cream. So tonight, we invite you to come from 6 to 8. Join us at the fountain as we gather to have an ice cream social. And we invite you to come and be a part of that. We'd also remind you that today is the day when we take up a special offering, our workday offering for Epworth Children's Home. We encourage you to prayerfully consider what you might do to help bless this ministry at Epworth. We also would remind you that on October 5th is St. John's Day at Epworth Children's Home, and we will be taking a work crew to go into work all day at Epworth Children's Home. And if you feel you're being called to do that today and for the next two Sundays, there will be those in the narthex as you leave that will be there to help you to sign up to come and be a part of that team. Would also remind you that this coming Wednesday, we begin our Wednesday night suppers once again, coupled with our Bible studies and our other activities, and we encourage you to be a part of that. New Member Sunday is September 22nd. If there are those of you who would like to become a part of the St. John's family, if you would, just call the church office or contact one of our pastors, and we would be delighted to work with you on that. Also, please know, men, that Tuesday night we will be resuming our men's Bible study. We will be studying the book of Proverbs. We'll be led by Dr. Tim. And that will be Tuesday evening, beginning at 6:30. I'd also remind those that tomorrow we have our Sunday Monday program for all of our adults that are 50 and older. And if you're under 50, you're welcome too. Begins at 10:30. We encourage you to come. And also, finally, those who might be a member of the class of 1955, any high school class of 1955, wherever it might be, there will be a celebration on October 20th at 4 o'clock. And if you're interested, please contact Donna Walker.
At this time, we're going to have our presentation of our third grade Bibles. This is a special event in the life of the congregation. I'm going to ask Heather Long, our children's ministry director, to come forward as she calls out the names of the individuals, these young people who will come and stand. Stand, all of you, please.
Shadow Mist Brian. Chance Donald Cook. Carter John Erford. Helen Diane Gaddis. Carson Wyatt Higgins. Grant Allen Kreitzer. Michael Chase Mole. Theodore Franklin Nichols Jr. Hudson Lee Paget. Zayden Alexander Page. Mary Lucia Reeves. Phoebe Kara Stephanakos. Bryn Patricia Turner. Mason David Wilhelm. And Hayden Grice Wyatt.
Receive the word of God. Learn its stories and study its words. Its stories belong to us all, and these words, the word of God, speaks to us all. They tell us who we are. They tell us that we belong to one another, for we are the children of God. So I want you to repeat after me, okay? Now look at me and repeat after me. We receive these Bibles with our hands, our hearts, and our minds. Thank you. We will read and study the Bible together. Now I want you to turn and face the congregation. Congregation, I'd like for you to repeat after me and say to these children, we rejoice in this step. In your journey with God. We pray God will guide you. Your family. And us. As you use this Holy Bible. In your home. In your church school classes. And in our worship. We will learn together. And grow in our love for God's Word. And now, children, I want you to say back to the congregation these words. Repeat after me. The Word of God is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Thanks be to God. Let's give a round of applause to these kids. Okay, you may be seated.
Let us stand together as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And may we pray together. Gracious God, we humbly come before you. We confess our sins and pray for your forgiveness. We pray that you might give us each new starts in our lives, whether we are in school or retired or at work, in relationships, in whatever circumstance we find ourselves in life, whether it be because of illness and poor health or sadness and grief. We pray for you to begin our lives anew, to give us hope, to give us encouragement. And Lord, help us not only to receive encouragement from you, help us to be inspired to encourage others, our fellow persons on this journey that we call life. Lord, we thank you as we saw this morning and celebrate with our third graders as they receive their Bibles. Lord, bless those Bibles, that indeed their words might be a lamp unto their feet. Please watch over each of them. Watch over all the children of the world, and we pray especially today in the aftermath of Hurricane Dorian, we pray for the children of the Bahamas, for all the families of that island archipelago. Offer them grace and strength, and help us to be your hands and feet as we give of ourselves to special offerings that will help them. And not only to them, but the special offerings we will give not only with our finances today, but also as we sign up to be a part of that ministry to Epworth Children's Home in Columbia. Lord, use us, we pray, in our neighborhoods, in our schools, in our government, in every avenue of life. Help us to be an encouragement, to give hope, to give grace. Hear our prayers that we pray in the name of Jesus as we pray together the prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now I would like to invite the ushers to come forward as we celebrate in this worship service what God has given to us. So may we give to God as God has blessed us.
Thank you.
standing for our hymn of preparation, hymn number 424. We ask for the children, ages K-3 through second grade, to follow the crucifer out for Children's Church in the chapel.
It's not often in church that the pastor preaches on an entire book of the Scripture, or reads it for that matter. But today I want you to hear these words from Philemon. Paul is writing to Philemon, who is from Colossae in the Macedonian plain between Greece and Turkey. He says, "Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, also to Apphia, our sister, his wife, and Archippus, his son, and fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home." Being one that I've never preached on Philemon in 41 years of ministry, I could stop right there and talk about how often does the church meet in our house? Wherever two or more gathered, Jesus says, "I'm there with you." And indeed, I believe the Lord lives in many of our homes. But I'm not going to preach that part of the text. As a matter of fact, it wasn't until the 3rd century that there started to be separate buildings just for church services. Up until then, people met in their homes. And so Paul continues in verse 3, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." And then he says about Philemon, he says, "I always thank my God, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all of the saints and your faith in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your partnership with us in the faith may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share for the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the Lord's people. Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I prefer to appeal to you on the basis of love. It is as none other than Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, that I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. I'm sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I'm in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do would not seem forced, but would be voluntary. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave. As a dear brother, he is very dear to me and even dearer to you, both as a fellow man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand, and I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. I do not wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. So refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I ask, and one thing more. Prepare a guest room for me, because I hope to be restored to you, set free from my chains, and answer to your prayers. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you greetings. And so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. And then he concludes in verse 25, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. A powerful passage of Scripture. If you're like me, I've received some robocalls that have had this perky, positive-sounding voice. Hello, how are you? And then they go into their spiel, and it's quite obvious that it's a recording. Hello, how are you? It sounds so enticing. It sounds so inviting, so encouraging. And some of we've also received pesky robocalls that have a real voice, not a recorded voice. We're from the Social Security Administration police, and we are going to collect from you. The police and sheriff are on their way now. But it's not in that plain of English, frankly. So perky or pesky, which works better in our lives in getting our attention? Well, it's a trick question, really, because there's not a choice between a nasty missive or a positive, kind word. It's a trick question. At least with robocalls, neither work. At least I hope. Not in your case or my case. Don't let them get you. They're not genuine, are they? They're not real, and I don't know about you, but I can spot a gold digger about 20 miles away. Fakery and quackery and all those things. A lack of sincerity is quite self-protection. But Philemon, in this short little book, these 25 verses, we find out how real Paul is in his relationship, not only with Philemon, but also with a former slave or a continued slave, however you want to look at the history of Philemon has a church that meets in his house. And, you know, wouldn't it be great? That would have been a great take on this passage, and I thought about it. To preach about whether or not we all have a church that meets at our house. Wouldn't that be interesting? So Philemon is this wealthy person from the city of Colossae, which is located on the Macedonian plain between Greece and Turkey. Paul had visited there, and Philemon had been one of his first converts, and he opened up his massive, well-to-do home and said, come to the church, it meets at our house. Now, we might think that's a little bit odd about churches meeting in houses, but it wasn't until the 3rd century AD that we started having separate buildings for church. For the first 300 years of the church's existence, people met together to worship in one another's homes. Interesting thought. So Philemon is this well-to-do person who has a church meeting at his house, because his house is an interesting character. We're really not sure what his name is, because Onesimus means useful. It's sort of a generic term for slave. Hey, useful, come here. How many of us have heard somebody say along the way in our lives, do something useful, hand me that, whatever it is. Make yourself useful and hand me that pair of pliers or that hammer or whatever it might be. So Onesimus is simply named useful. A situation has arisen that Onesimus, useful, has made himself useless to his master Philemon. He has escaped, and in the midst of his escape, he's taken something with him of value from his master. Now, Paul is not writing a dissertation or a treatise about slavery. He's writing about how two people ought to get back together and reconcile. Because Philemon has become a Christian under Paul's teaching, and Onesimus, who is named useful, who has become useless because he's a runaway slave, finds himself in the city of Rome where Paul is in chains for the gospel. And then Paul says, well, now that you're a Christian, you need to do the right thing. You need to go back to Colossae. You need to go back to Philemon, your master, and make things right. And so he writes this letter to Philemon, to pave the way so that Philemon and Onesimus get back together. They reconcile. That they become not just master-slave, but that they become brother-to-brother as fellow Christians. Well, that's the kind of world we live in, doesn't it? When we have such partisanship and such political divides and such differences of income, such differences of racial issues, such differences that I don't need to go into because we see them on television or hear them in the news every day. There are divisions among us. So how does Paul accomplish this? Well, first it says he tries to make it personal. You know, it's interesting about Philemon in terms of being personal. It's only personal letters that are in the entire New Testament. You have Philemon, this letter that Paul writes to this one individual, but somehow ends up being in the Bible because it makes sense for all of us, and that's how it's in the Scriptures, to teach us how to get along with each other and get along with the world around us. The other personal letter, the only other personal letter in the Scriptures, is 3 John, where the Apostle John has written a letter to a man named Gaius, G-A-I-U-S. So it's an unusual thing to have a personal letter, and it's even more unusual that this personal letter that Paul says, I write it in my own hand, because if he stole anything from you when he ran away, charge it to me. It's a personal thing, but it becomes something that can help all of us and how we get along with each other. And so what does Paul try to do to make it happen? First of all, he does what I call a use of charm. A use of charm. Now, there are different kinds of charm. You've heard perhaps of a charm offensive. You know, when you're trying to use a campaign of flattery and friendliness and buttering up that are designed to achieve the support of others. A charm offensive is still, in my mind, offensive because it's a manipulation. It's fake. It's not real. They don't really like you when they use a charm offensive on you. They're trying to butter you up. We Southerners have a way of charming people. I don't know if you've ever read anything by Arthur Gordon. He's got a great book called A Touch of Wonder. It's a little bit dated nowadays, but it's still a superb book of short stories, A Touch of Wonder. And he's got one chapter, and he spent time up north. He ended up at the end of his career as a reporter and editor for the Atlanta Journal. And so this is what he says. In the past century or two, down here in the Deep South, we've managed to get rid of a respectable number of nuisances. Yellow fever and carpetbaggers are no more. Mosquitoes have mellowed, and so have rural sheriffs. But one velvet trap that still awaits the unwary visitor is the subtle, insidious, silken snare of charm. As you may have noticed with some dismay, most Southerners would rather be charming than rich. They believe that you can devote your energies to either making money or to being delightful, but you really can't do both. When faced with the choice, they don't even hesitate because some ancient ancestral instinct whispers that charm will get a charmer all sorts of things that money can't begin to buy. I'd forgotten how pervasive and powerful this lifestyle is until I moved back to my hometown of Savannah after several uneasy years in the north. In this languorous old seaport of Savannah, the output of charm per capita is unbelievable. Visitors are often struck by such a deluge of it that they go bobbing around, dazed and helpless like bewildered cherries in a sea of whipped cream. And when there are no visitors, Savannians keep in practice by charming one another. At first, exposure to such expert charmers can be delightful. You feel flattered, uplifted, bemused, and enchanted. You never dreamed that you were so good-looking, so witty, so irresistible. It takes a while for the dark realization to creep in that, as a matter of fact, you're not. I discovered, or rather rediscovered, this within 48 hours of my return. It was a golden Sunday morning. On the church steps, I met a friend of my mother's, a tall lady in a flowered hat, who took my hand and held it tenderly and said, "My dear." A warning bell, he says, should have gone off in my ears because I wasn't even remotely her dear. "My dear," she said, "I've never seen you looking so young or so handsome. You certainly do brighten the day." I went into church feeling quite exhilarated. A moment later, I came out looking for one of our children who was late, and as I did, my eye fell upon an old acquaintance that I'd seen the night before, whooping it up at a memorable party. He was tottering up the steps, bright eyes and a pale green face. "My dear," my mother's friend was saying to him, "how marvelous you are." And I thought to myself, a howling hypocrite? Not at all. She was just being what she'd been conditioned to do since the age of 3. Charming, no matter what. And then he goes on to say, lastly, charm isn't all play acting, however. It isn't all self-centeredness. Charm, in its very true form, is a reaching out. It is a small voice saying, "Look, I'm aware of you. I know you're there. I want you to like me, sure, but I also want you to feel easier about yourself." Call it charm, call it caring, he goes on to say. It's something we need badly in this mechanized, fragmented, de-stand everything. So you all come on down and get charmed. It won't hurt a bit. It might be good for everybody. And you ask, any employee or spouse or friend of someone or loved one, what they most need from a relationship is recognition. And recognition best comes to us from how well we charm each other. And sometimes, I must admit, Southern charm does have its limits. You've heard the story about the two Southern belles who are sitting on the veranda of this great big house, on the porch, in other words, but in the South, we call it a veranda. It was Darlene and Ellie Mae. And Darlene looked at her friend Ellie Mae and said, "You see my 6-carat diamond on my hand? My husband, Billy Bob, gave it to me. It wasn't our anniversary. It wasn't my birthday. He just said, 'Here, honey, I think it'll look good on you.'" And her friend Ellie Mae said, "How nice." And then she said, "You see the red Cadillac convertible under the magnolia over there? He gave me the keys one day and said, I think you'll look good in this car." And then her friend Ellie Mae said to Darlene, "How nice." And a minute or two later, Darlene said, "And you know why last year he sent me on a 10-day cruise? He said, you go and spend all the money you need to buy all the clothes you want to. I'm not even going to go with you. You dance with whomever you want to dance. You just have fun and enjoy yourself." And Ellie Mae said to Darlene, "How nice." And then Darlene says to Ellie Mae, "Done for me. Has your husband ever done anything like that for you?" And Ellie Mae said, "Why, yes. Now, instead of saying drop dead, I say, how nice. He sent me to charm school." Charm school. You know, charm is not a lie like that. You know, it isn't a kind way to say drop dead, you egotist. It's a way for us to connect and be honest with each other. And that's exactly what Paul tries to do in these short 25 verses. He uses two phrases in Greek that are only used about 20 times in the whole New Testament, and they're both used twice in this passage of Scripture, in this short little book, in these mere 25 verses. So 10% of the use of these two Greek words, two Greek phrases, 10% of all of their use in the New Testament is in this little book of Philemon. And this little was the winning word in last year's, 2018, in last year's, I got to get my Southern accent back out of the way now, in last year's Scripps Howard National Spelling Bee. The winning word last year, I always found it interesting that they showed the National Spelling Bee on ESPN. There's something that doesn't quite match with that, but nevertheless they do. But the winning word was the word koinonia. Now, a lot of us haven't heard that word since we knew somebody in a folk rock band in the early 70s named Koinonia that played some Christian music. Or you've heard of perhaps of Koinonia Farms. It's kind of a Christian commune sort of thing. But koinonia in the Greek, it literally means a partnership, a fellowship. More than a friendship, it means community. Koinonia. So Paul uses that word, and he says what we need in the church, and he's trying to get this past slave owner and past runaway slave back together. And so he says, we have a community because we are one in Christ. There is no Jew, nor Greek, nor male, nor female, barbarian, Scythian, slave, or free. We're all one in Christ. At the foot of the cross, the ground is level. We all need his rationale for them to get back together, that they should have koinonia. The other word is a little more interesting. And it's going to sound a little bit like potty talk.
But it's what Paul says. The other two words are anapao splagnon. And you're like, what? Well, I've talked before about the word nephros, where we get nephrology from today. It's, you know, nephros is the Greek word for kidney. The Greeks had this notion, especially about splagnon, that was the seat of our emotions. So the phrase anapao splagnon means refresh my bowels. You know, sounds more like Charmin than charming. Should be the topic. But what Paul is trying to get across is that all of our feelings happen in our gut. You know, when you're nervous, you have what? Butterflies. Perhaps angry, you have a knot in your stomach. When you're happy about something, you might have a belly laugh, Santa Claus style, the jolly old Saint Nick. Sometimes when you're pondering things, somebody might say to you, go with your gut. There's something we feel punched in the stomach. Or, lastly, I shall say, the way to a man's heart is how? Through his stomach. So maybe the Greeks had something going for them that we still recognize a bit today, that if we want to get somewhere back to community where we're together, where we are reconciled, where we've forgiven one another, maybe our gut needs to be refreshed. Anapao splagnon, encouragement, is what it really says. Paul says it to Philemon, encourage me, refresh my bowels. encourage me by you two getting along. Now, it's hard sometimes for us to get along because instead of us hearing kind words, we more often than not hear words that are not that kind. It was in 1873 that Dr. Brewster Hiley wrote a poem that's become the state song of Kansas that we all know, Home on the Range. Home on the Range, where the deer and the antelope play, where seldom is heard a discouraging word, and the skies aren't cloudy all day. But I dare say it's not the discouraging words that have been made absent from our vocabulary in our society. What we've lost hold of is the evidence of encouraging words. How wonderful you are. When's the last time anybody said that to anybody? Except for our grandchildren. How wonderful you are. I mean, we've lost out to discouragement. You know, it's interesting. Charlie Brown and Lucy, you know, Lucy's just a pill. I mean, she just is. I remember one cartoon when Lucy puts her hands on her hip and she says to Charlie Brown, after he's done one of his usual Charlie Brown loser type kinds of things, and she says to him, and I quote, Charlie Brown, you are a foul ball in the line goal post. You are a miscue. You are three putts on the 18th green. You are a 7-10 split in the 10th frame. You are a drop rod and reel in the lake of life. You are a missed free throw, a shanked 9-iron. You are a called third strike. Do you understand, Charlie Brown? Have I made myself clear? Oh, yes, you have. That's not an encouraging word. That's a discouraging word or two. Have you ever had any Lucys around you? Have you ever been like Lucy around other people? Oh, mercy, I'm afraid that we have. Discouragement is one of the devil's most important tools. It causes us to give up hope and to find ourselves unable to move forward in life. So Paul says to Philemon and to Onesimus, whose name meant useless, useful, who's become useless. If you want to become useful again, if you two want to get along with each other, then encourage. How much better would you think our world would be if we encouraged each other? Not looking for the bad, not expecting the bad, but if we actually encouraged. Our spouses might think we've been out doing something we shouldn't be and are acting foolish, but wouldn't it be grand if we tried this experiment this week, that rather than ever saying a discouraging word, we said, "Of course, how wonderful you are." They'll get over thinking that we're lying after a little bit. Indeed. Let me tell you about the power of encouragement. It comes from a story about a fellow whose dad died when he was 5 years old. This boy dropped out of school after the sixth grade. By the time he was 17, he had lost job after job after job. He married at 18, had a baby at 19, and was separated from his wife by the age of 20. He became a railroad conductor, but he got fired. He joined the army, but he washed out. He became a farmer, but he lost his shirt. He applied to law school, but got turned down. He became an insurance salesman and couldn't give it away. Finally, he became a dishwasher and a cook in a two-bit restaurant. But one thing he was able to do was finally persuade his wife to come back. And you're all wondering, like me, what was wrong with her? But he persuaded his wife to come back to him. And together they made a living cooking and washing dishes in that little restaurant. At 65, he wrote a Social Security check that was a grand total of $105. This 65-year-old man was so discouraged, he decided that life wasn't worth living. So he went under a shade tree, he wrote out his last will and testament, determined to end his life. Well, somehow his wife found out about his scheme. She confronted him under that tree and said, "Let me tell you," but she didn't do it with discouraging words. She said, "Let me tell you one thing you can do. I believe you can do it better than anybody I've ever known." And he asked, "What's that?" And she said, "You can cook. You can cook better than any man I've ever met. Your recipes are fantastic. You're fabulous." That's what she said. And he asked, "Do you really think so?" She said, "You're the best." Well, that encouragement gave him an hard $87 against his $105 Social Security check. He went to the supermarket. He bought some chicken. He bought some boxes. He fried it up with a special recipe that he had developed all on his own. He put it in boxes and began going door to door in Corbin, Kentucky, selling his chicken. It became so popular, he came up with an idea to try to sell it to restaurants, and guess what? He was turned down 1,104 times before a man named John Y. Brown, who, like his wife, also saw potential and wanted to encourage this man. John Brown tasted his chicken and said, "It's so good, I want to go in business with you." That man's name was Colonel Harlan Sanders. You already figured that out. The founder of Kentucky Fried Chicken. And what was the secret? Was it the secret sauce? Was it the secret recipe? No, it was the same man. It was the same recipe, the same ability, and the same chicken. The only difference was a word of encouragement. Oh, Lord, help us. Every chance we get to encourage others, to bring a blessing to others, to break barriers for others, to build bridges for others. You know what the amazing thing is you'll find? You will be encouraged in the process of encouraging somebody else. So I dare you this week. As we live in this home on the range, where seldom is heard a discouraging word, let's make it true. Encourage people all you can. And then, this little book of Philemon, this one page long, you can refresh somebody else's life, gut and all. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you will use us as instruments of your kindness and goodness, instruments of your love, instruments of your power to bless other people. Please, Lord, inspire us to not look for the bad in other people, but to look for the good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you please rise as we sing our hymn of dedication, hymn number 438, Forth in the Name and Thy Name, O Lord. As we prepare to go forth this morning, let us go forth like Barnabas, as a people of encouragement. Know that as you leave this place and you go into the streets of Aiken, you go as the hands of Christ, reaching out to touch and to love others, and go forth knowing that you're speaking the loving words of Christ in the lives of all others. Receive the benediction. May our loving and caring God make his face to shine upon you. May he make his loving arms to embrace you. And may he make his Holy Spirit to dwell within you, now and forevermore. Amen.